Till I met you. You Celebrating with you in victory, or how we can be praying for you and what you're going through right now. So if you have anything that you'd like to tell us about, we sure would take that now. I do want to mention, we do know we missed Monty Meeks, taking him off our prayer list to do the sympathy to the family. So we do realize that. So just letting everybody know if you looked at the list. How can we be praying for you or celebrating with you today? Yes, ma'am.
Well, I have a couple. Mary May, everybody's probably heard, she's in the hospital with cancer. And then a gentleman I work with, his name is Chris Quinn Campbell. I'm sorry, I don't know how to say the last name.
Chris W.
He lost his son, Dustin, and he was a kid that drowned up out of Great Falls on the river. So I work with Chris.
Mary May and Chris W. family.
It's like Quinn Kilia or something.
Quinn?
Yeah, it's a Q.
Q.
Yeah.
Chris Q. Any others? Yes, ma'am.
Well, I want to do a book for you. So he
praise with you for the $1,000 you raised for that family. That's awesome. Yep. And then Deb's going to be gone for a month, and so we'll be praying for you on that, and then God will help take care of Martin, too. So, any others?
Yeah,
I'll say,
have you
all
seen the 2 Sundays in a row checkering?
Yeah, okay. I'll go down and drag them out of the house. So.
Yeah, because that would be odd if you're not seeing 2 Sundays.
Yeah. Okay. I was probably going to see if he was okay anyway, so. There you go. Any others? We just want to continue praying for our country as well with the things that are going on in some of the major metropolitan areas with the protests and the riots and the racism that is going on. And so we want to be praying for those leaders and be praying for those people that are involved with it. It's one of those things where you look at it, and again, it's one of those things where we go, thank you, Lord, for letting us live here in Montana. There's not a whole lot going on here, and that was one of the things I wanted to share with you. Some of you might receive emails from Dale Mueller. Do you guys receive emails from Dale Mueller? Did you read the update that he gave this last time? I wanted to read it to you because he's been stuck in the Philippines where he's at because of the virus. And they're a lot more worse off than we are here as far as their government goes and as far as kind of the local leaders go. And so I wanted to share with you from Dale what he said. He says, "Dear friends, I'm still alive. These last 3 months have been very trying for me, as I know it has been for most of you. I'm physically healthy. However, these months have really worn me down. June 1st was my first time out of the church building since early March. I was able to attend the private family 7th birthday celebration of Arnell and Audrine Garcia, twin boys. Arnell has been working side by side with me for 31 years. Except when recording Sunday services, he was almost the only person I saw for 3 months. As a senior citizen, I am still restricted on going out. Since March 15th, our church service has been online. Recently, we have been able to record or broadcast live from the church building with only 5 or 6 people for music and preaching. This coming Sunday, we are allowed to expand that to 10 people. Our provincial church in Reggae will be allowed to have regular service this Sunday for the first time. That also includes the church in Salvacion, Reggae, where we finished up a new building in February. They only had 2 or 3 services in their new building before being shut down by the COVID-19 crisis. They are super excited to get back to their building. My June 17 plane ticket to Montana has long since been rebooked for July 15th. The airport is still mostly shut down. Even my July 15th ticket has gone through several reschedulings and reroutings. Only the Lord knows if I will see any of you in July or not. Right now, my biggest concern is our church members and community. Government aid has been rife with corruption. Many of the poorest have been left with next to nothing. We are about to do a 4th round of financial help through the church. God has graciously provided, but the long-term prospects for our people is not good. Some are gradually being allowed to return to work, but without public transportation and the assurance that they will be paid. Those that are paid are often getting only 50% or less of their normal pay, even though they work full time. Overtime is often required without compensation. Most will do it just to hold on to their jobs. Many companies are simply going out of business. The long-term prospects for thousands of seamen and cruise ship workers is in doubt. Our student support program is now in doubt for a variety of reasons. First, after this ordeal, many will simply not return to school. Second, school opening dates are not sure. The usual first week of June opening has been pushed to late August. There are rumors that if it will be postponed until next year. Third, school officials are thinking of using online programs, but that does not work well with our community. Few have the equipment or connections to sustain that long term, and fewer still in this environment have the motivation to remain focused. Please pray for wisdom. Overall, people here are struggling in normal times. Now they are hurting even more. My heart goes out to them while I am here. I will do what my budget allows. Sadly, what I do is only a drop in the bucket. We are only one country of dozens in the same or worse shape. COVID-19 crisis continue to rise. Please pray for our spiritual, mental, and physical health as we will pray for you. Pray that all will see their eternal hope in Christ alone. We are easing into the rainy season. Days are super hot, humid, with occasional thunder showers that will become more frequent until monsoon rains begin sometime soon. I do hope to see you in Montana next month. I remain grateful for the opportunity you all have given me to serve the people of Asia for the last 34 years. To God be the glory in Christ daily. That's just one glimpse of what's happening around the world. Dale Mueller is a missionary that we've supported for a very long time here. He was an elder at Haver, still is an elder, kind of at Haver. And he's a missionary that we support over in the Philippines. And he spreads the gospel in the mountains of the Philippines and to a very poor culture. And so we're very fortunate to live in Montana, but this is global. The economic crisis is global. And it's pending on these third world countries that are desperate for help. And so be praying that God would continue to see us through it, that God would help these people that are the most vulnerable and the most desperate, because it's bad around the globe. It's not just here. It's because of the virus has shut these down. And thankfully, our economy here and our government here has been able to sustain this long hiatus that we've been on, but not around the globe. So be praying for those people, if you would. So, if there's nothing else, I would, yes, sir.
I suppose Dale's got to be into his 70s in age.
Yeah.
He's not a young man by no means.
Nope. So, he's doing good, though, he said. Will you pray with me? God, I just come to you to thank you for this day, and thank you, Lord, again, for the opportunity to worship. But Lord, as we come to you now, as a body, Lord, that you would just help us to have humble hearts and lift those up around us that are hurting. Father, for the Meeks family, we continue to pray for them as they heal, as they mourn, as they get through the loss of Monty. And Lord, for Mary, the news that she got, it's terrible, Lord. And so we ask that you would comfort her. Put people in our life that are going to encourage her and be there for her and love her, Lord. Father, we want to pray for Chris as he's lost a son, Lord, at a very young age. It's terrible, Lord. I think about my children in instances like this, and it hurts my heart. It breaks my heart, Lord. Not because, Lord, it's I'm thinking about my kids, but to what it would be like to lose one, to be in Chris's shoes, to sympathize with him, to empathize with him, Lord, to feel his pain. And so, Lord, I want to ask that you would be with him and his family. That's a terrible thing, Lord. Father, we do want to ask that you would be with our country as we recover from this virus. And Lord, our country is kind of in a desperate situation where people have been cooped up and idle for a while, and then Father, the thing with George Floyd happened, and just terrible things are happening right now, and people are upset and angry. And Father, and then there's the other side that are turning to crime, to loot, to raid, Lord. And we pray for some reform, Lord, but we also pray for cooler heads to prevail. Lord, we understand that none of this is going to go away until you come and get us. So your truth and justice reign. Lord, so we just pray that you would see us through it, that you would help those that are affected, that you would help us to have a heart with them. Father, it's awful. And Father, we pray for the world as well. The land is hurting, the people are hurting. They're being oppressed by governments. They're being shut down. They're being forced to work without pay. Just a glimpse into where Dale's at, Lord. We got a glimpse of it. And so, Father, we ask that you would heal this land. We ask that you would bring it back. Father, we ask that, most importantly, that your will would be done through all of this, that your kingdom would come, no matter what. Father, we praise you for the good things in this life. We praise you for those that are healthy. We praise you for the rain last night. We praise you, Lord, that people are healing from afflictions and health, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Deb and Martin and those people that came and bought the things from their garage sale that raised almost $1,000 for this family, that possibly going to be $1,000 for this family. So, Lord, we're excited to hear that. And we want to celebrate with Deb and Martin. But, Father, as we celebrate with them, Lord, we ask that you would go ahead of Deb on her journey to go help her family. Father, that you would protect her and that you would give her the words to say to comfort her family. And Father, as she leaves Martin here for a while, that you would help him to stay healthy, to stay upright, Lord, to get to where he's going, and Lord, that you would impress it upon our hearts to be there for him as well. Lord, we do thank you so much for all that you do in our lives. And Father, we ask that you would forgive us of our sin, where we fall short. Lord, I'm guilty, and I'm thankful for you in my life. Lord, I'm thankful that you called me out of the grave and into the glorious light. Thank you. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the sacrifice that was made on the cross. It's in Jesus' precious and holy name that I do pray. Amen. We're going to sing To Live as Christ for our communion song. Do you want to direct your attention?
If I grow, let me grow in you. Wilt the seeds of wanting more, ripping pride out by the roots. And if I'm still, let me hear you speak. Not the tone of my transgressions, but the song of the redeemed. For me, for me.
songs and saw the words, saw those pictures of the earth upon winged wings. You know, you think about God looking down upon the earth. What does he see? He sees a glorious globe in the darkness. But I think he sees all points of light upon that globe, each and every one of us. His creations that are here, his creations that he created, are all those points of light. To die is to gain. We have to die to our old selves to be born new and fresh through Christ our Lord, our Savior. And that's what happened upon that cross. He gave us that great, glorious gift of life in him, being washed by his Son, his death, and his resurrection. You know, in the book of Micah, 7th chapter, verses 18 and 19, it says this: Who is a God like you who pardons sin and forgives the transgressions of the remnants of the inheritance? You do not stay angry for it. You delight to show mercy. You again will have compassion on us, will have tread our sins underfoot, and have hurled all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. He delights to show mercy. Do you delight to be here? Do you take delight in knowing that our Father loves us so? He did not do it out of a duty. He did not do it because it was expected of him. He shows us mercy because he loves us so. Because he wants each and every one of us to be with him. What a glorious message. What a glorious thought we have. As we partake of these emblems that represent our Lord and our Savior dying, it also represents the love of the Father who sent his Son to die for us, to give us life eternal, to give us that great promise, to show us mercy and grace for all time. The hope is we partake of these emblems that we take delight in knowing where we will be. We're going to be in heaven with our Father. What a glorious thought, what a glorious thing. These times are so trivial. They seem so great right now. But we're going to look back at them someday and say, wow, that was sure easy to get through because I had God. I knew where I would be in eternity. As we partake of these emblems this day, I want each and every one of us to look forward to that time when we will be with our Father in heaven, when we will be our Lord and our Savior Jesus ever once again with us. So as we partake, I just want each and every one of us to look into our hearts and have great joy in what has happened for us, in what we partake of. So as we come to this time, I'll say a prayer, and then we can come forward and go in the back. There's some trays there, and we can partake our own time and thank the Lord. Heavenly Father, what a glorious, glorious gift you've given to us. The mercy that you've shown to us through your Son. You've given to us the greatest gift there can be, life eternal. Father, we partake of these emblems each Sunday, but never do we take them lightly. They mean so much to us. They help us to remember and always dwell with our Lord and our Savior. Let him live in our hearts. Fathers, we partake this day whole. And I know that each other and one that is here is so glad. Just so, so thankful for you, your Son. Father, please bless us and look after us always throughout all time. In your Son's name I pray. Amen.
about you, but the Spirit's been really moving through me this morning, and I feel like an emotional wreck up here, so bear with me. We are continuing our sermon series on extraordinary God, unusual circumstances. And we talked, I think it was 2 weeks ago, about the boy that was thrown into the river, Moses. And we talked about kind of the first part of those things that was happening in his life. And one of the scriptures that stuck out, one of the New Testament scriptures that sticks out to me with the life of Moses is James 1:12. It says, "Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him." And we'll understand today about standing the test of time, because Moses' life is one of those things full of unusual circumstances, from his inception all the way to his death. Moses is actually regarded as one of the most loved Old Testament prophet ever. He's the one who basically talked directly with God and got the law from him of how life was to be for them and how it was going to be. He led them to the promised land. But we talked about his life a couple weeks ago about how he was born in a time where essentially the Pharaoh issued an abortion edict to the people of Egypt and said, "Hey, throw those Israelite baby boys in the river." Okay? And so he was born in this time where his mom protected him and hid him, and when she couldn't hide him any longer, she built a small boat for him and said, God protect him, and stuck him in the river. And wouldn't you know it, Pharaoh's daughter finds him. And she takes care of him as his son. So Moses becomes a prince of Egypt. Some of you might recall the movie that was called Prince of Egypt. It's a pretty good movie. It's fairly close to the accurate description of the biblical account. And so he's raised as an enemy of the Israelites, being an Israelite himself, okay? And he comes to grips with that one day where he's realizing something about himself. He's realizing, "I don't look like my mom, I don't look like my brother, but I look like these people. I have their skin complexion, I have their nose, I have their hair, and when I let it grow, I don't look like them. I look at my reflection and I see them." And I'm sure somewhere in there he felt the tug that he was one of them, or his mom or his sister might have been like, you're one of us. And he goes out one day and he sees an Egyptian taskmaster mistreating an Israelite, and he kills the Egyptian taskmaster. And he's afraid for his life from his brother, who is now king, and he flees. He goes to the desert and he meets a woman. He begins to have children with her, works for his father-in-law as a sheep herder. Now that in itself is an unusual circumstance, because he grew up as an Egyptian who despised herdsmen, who despised people that would work with such filthy animals. Because Egyptians were very much about clean skin and everything. Despised that lifestyle. And yet when we find him in the desert, what is he doing? He's a herdsman. He's out in the desert, and God comes to him, speaks to him through a bush. A bush is burning on fire, but it's not burning up. And he's like, "What?" He goes over to it and begins inspecting it. And as he gets close to it, he hears from the bush, "Take off your shoes, because where you're standing is holy ground." And he's like, "Dude, I'm out here by myself, and there's talking voices." He doesn't yet know God. He doesn't yet have a relationship with God. And God tells him in that moment to go back to Egypt, where he's a fugitive, where he's a murderer, and to go to your brother the king and say, "Let my people go." "No, surely, Lord, you don't mean me. Surely you don't want me to go back. You don't understand. They know who I am. place where people knew who you were. Oh, it's that kid. He's come home to rule the roost, I guess. And he's that person. He's that person. They look at you and they don't think you've changed your stripes. But yet Christ has done something in you. Changed who you are. Changed what you do and how you act and what you say. You see, this is what God did for Moses. Moses had every excuse in the book why he couldn't go back. He said, nope, I can't go back, send somebody else. Nope, you don't want me, God, I'm not good enough. Nope, you don't want me, I can't talk. Finally, God gets mad and says, fine, your brother can talk for you. There was something special about Moses. There was something special about his life. There was something special about his heart. Moses can't see in the future. We can't see into the future. We can't predict what is going to happen tomorrow. We might have a general idea of what we're going to do, but we never know what's going to happen. I liken it to what happened to me just Friday. I didn't expect to be pulling some guy out of a wrecked semi this week. I was there. It was scary. It was exciting. I didn't know if a guy was dead or alive.
How is he?
He's great.
Oh, good.
You know, I like him to not know. You know, I had this plan in my mind what was going to happen, but then God had this opportunity for me. Thankfully, I reacted like I thought I would. You know, we never know how we're going to react in situations. We never know how God is going to work through us in those situations, in those unusual circumstances that we have in our lives. But we have to believe that God is always extraordinary through it. You know, we look at the things happening in metropolitan areas right now, in Seattle, in LA, in Minneapolis, and we think, what is going on? We don't have a clue what God is doing through this. We don't have a clue what God is going to do on the other side. But we can pray and have faith that God will see us through it because it's extraordinary. You see, that was Moses. Moses was asked by God, he said, I want you to go back and tell your brother who you grew up with to let those people go. But also you need to tell him that he's, because of his hard heart, he's going to lose his firstborn son. So he goes back and he does that. And God has kept his promise through the whole thing. And where we left off 2 weeks ago was a crazy ride because he had gone into Egypt and said, let him go. And Pharaoh said, nah, your God's not cool enough or not big enough. He can't do anything to me. I'm God of this land. I'm God of the world right now. And you can't do anything to me. Your puny God can't. Our gods are bigger than yours. Most of us know this, the rest of the story, the 10 plagues ensue. And every plague is a direct insult to one of their gods. They worship the Nile, they worship their bodies, they worship the land, they worship everything. The god of this, the god of that. The god of the sun was Ra. God made the sky go black. You see, God begins to deliver. God begins to show up extraordinarily in their lives. God begins to deliver because Moses lives through those unusual circumstances and he has faith of what God is going to do. Most of us know at the end of the 10 plagues that Pharaoh's heart is broken and he says, you know what? Get out of my land. Take your stuff, take your people, and get out. His heart's broke. His son's dead. He leaves. The Israelites leave. The Pharaoh doesn't leave. The Israelites leave. They go out into the desert. They're walking in the desert. They get. I don't know how far. It never describes how far they get out of Egypt. When they realize, uh-oh, they want us back. They cry out to Moses. The mob cries out to Moses and says, Moses, you brought us out here to the desert because there wasn't enough graves in Egypt. You want us to die. They're going to kill us out here. And what does Moses do? He says, God, what are you going to do? He consults with God. He goes to God and he says, what are we going to do? And you know, that's what you and I, that's an example of what you and I need to do. In the midst of our unusual circumstances, you know, what do we try to do? We try to rely on our own strength to get us through sometimes. We're like, I can fix this, I can do that. But what we see Moses doing here, he goes straight to God. God, what are we supposed to do? God comes down, poof, and a big pillar of fire stops the Egyptians. Gives them time to cross the Red Sea. Puts a cloud of smoke around them while they're pursuing them. It's pretty awesome. If you've never read the account, I encourage you to read the story. God rescues them. God saves them. God extraordinarily shows up. And then when they're on the other side of the Red Sea, they're wandering around in the desert again going, what are we supposed to do now? We don't have anything to eat. We don't have anything to drink. You're going to kill us again, aren't you, Moses? And yet the burden falls on Moses, not on God, on the people of God. They don't turn to God. They turn to the man. Can you see how difficult that must have been for Moses? To have the whole nation bearing down upon you. To feel the whole world on your shoulders. I know I feel that way sometimes. How about you? I feel like the whole world is stacked upon our shoulders. The deck is stacked against us. We're not playing with a fair deck. You ever felt that way? Right? I feel that way a lot. But God continues to provide. He gives them water out of rocks. He feeds them with bread from dew, manna and quail. He gives them birds to eat as well. You see, they begin to realize that God is extraordinary. Moses has seen God time and time again, but it still doesn't discount him being human. He's just like us. He feels that pressure. He feels that weight. He feels those unusual circumstances, but he doesn't know what to do. And then the people rebel. It's sad. They rebel. And they would rather have spent a life in Egypt eating meat and food as a slave than they would be a free people. And so God says, you know what? Because of that, you're going to wander around in this desert for a long time. They get lost. They don't trust God. They accuse him. And they think that the desert is far more sinister than being a slave. They accuse Moses. They accuse God. I think about us in our modern societies. We sometimes get lost and we get distracted by the things that aren't important. Yes, food and water are very necessary for living. Don't get me wrong. But they're not as important as following God. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus tells us that God clothes the lilies of the field or feeds the birds of the air. He takes care of them. Doesn't he care more about his creation that looks like him than the flowers and the birds? He says, don't worry about that stuff. Don't worry about what you'll eat or drink. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. That's what Jesus tells us to do. But they were lost. They were lost in their rebellion. They were lost. We were lost in our rebellion. God found us. He came to us. He rescued us. He pulled us out of slavery. He pulled us out of the grave. You see, that wasn't enough. The people see God at every turn. God extraordinarily shows up at every turn in this journey of the Israelites, and yet they continue to rebel. And it got to the point where God had had enough. Most of you might know the story, but I'll share it with you. Moses is called up on the mountain by God to go receive the Ten Commandments, the two stone tablets that God would write himself. And the people were like, well, Moses has been gone a long time, which he's only been gone about 40 days by this time. And they're like, well, he's gone. He's not coming back. We need a new leader, Aaron. We need a new God to worship. And so they craft this golden calf. God says, I've had enough. He said, the fathers will not see the promised land. Because of this sin, they'll not see the promised land. And they all have to die before they get to the promised land. And it makes me think about how sometimes people walk away completely from God because they don't see the goodness of God. They don't see the cost in the cross. They just don't see it. They only see themselves through this. They're like, why me? Poor me. Why this? Why that? You ever found yourself in that situation asking those questions? Why me? Why not you? Why not let God show up extraordinarily in your life so people can see the light that is in you? Why not you? This suffering does not last forever, I promise. Scripture tells us so. Jesus says, I'm going to build a place for you and I'm going to come back and get you. The suffering will not be in vain. And the Israelites, they suffered. They'd had enough. They said, forget God. We're going to do our own thing. We need something else. But what does God do to them? They're living one way, and God says, I want you to live this way. Here's a new way to live. We know it's the Ten Commandments. God says, see, I want you to live by these. I want you to live and breathe and move in these. I want you to love me and I want you to love other people. I want you to show what it's like to be a follower of me. Live differently. I think Jesus asks us to do that as well. I think Jesus asks us to live differently. The reward is coming, I promise. See, the Israelites were promised a land that was flowing with milk and honey. Eventually. It took a little bit of time, but they got there. 40 years or so. 40 years doesn't seem like a long time because I'm 40. I'm like, man, I feel like I was 10 just yesterday. Some days, my shoulder doesn't hurt. Right? You know? But they were rewarded. And that's the thing with Moses. The thing with Moses about his whole entire life, from the beginning to the end, Moses didn't get to see the promised land here on earth. Moses didn't get to walk into that land. Because he, like the Israelites before him, failed God, didn't trust God, didn't have faith enough in God. And he took it upon himself to fix the problem. And you and I know you and I do the same things. You and I turn to our own strength. You and I turn to our own devices and say, I'm going to fix this. Sometimes we lose our temper and we get angry or we say, you know what, I'm just going to do that. But what does God call us to do? He calls us a new way to live, to love him and to love others. He calls us to be his hands and his feet. No matter what. No matter what the cost. That's what he calls us to do. Moses, thankfully, was willing to bear that cost. Moses was willing to give us an example of what it is to live through an unusual amount of circumstances and to see God's power on display. Think back in your life how you've seen God work. Think how you've seen God work extraordinarily through some of your pain, through some of your triumph, through some of your life. Recall that. Moses' life was not in vain. Moses showed us how extraordinary God can be. Yet that same God is our God. See, God sent Jesus to rescue us from the slavery of sin. He defeated it, defeated death through resurrection. Jesus shows us a new way to live, and that promise of our eternity is waiting. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial. Because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life. The promise that the Lord has promised us who love him. Pray with me. God, I just come to you to thank you for this day. And Lord, I thank you, Lord, that we have the example that is in Moses. We look at him and see an extraordinary man. But Lord, I want us to see Moses as just a man who lived for you. And you were the extraordinary one, Lord. You delivered on every single thing you promised them. I thank you for that. I thank you for that unfailing love. And Lord, help us in our time of need. Under the things that crush us, Lord, that you would help us to see that example and to live for you. The new way to live, Lord. Love you and to love others and everything that we are. No matter the cost, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. This precious and holy name that I do pray. Amen. Thank you for being here today. As always, if you need someone to talk to, my office is always open. Our elders are available to talk to as well. And if you have never heard about Jesus loving you, and you want to talk more about it, I'm available to talk about how Jesus can be your Savior, your rescuer in your life. So go and love God and love others. Live the new way and be an example in this community and in your life. I love you guys. Have a great week.